Just want a quick summary. How many developers do we have in the project? Project developers? Okay. Regulators? Operators? No. Mostly project developers. Government regulators, right? Okay. So my presentation is to talk about how the captive farm market can be positioned to incentivize local institutional investors like pension funds. I will, in the course of my presentation, talk about InfraCredit. I don't want to distract from the main thing. But in the course of my presentation, I'll also reference InfraCredit. First slide looks at the market opportunity. I'm going to jump straight into my presentation. I think John did a very excellent job in talking about the market, so I don't need to repeat that. So the market opportunity in Nigeria is that we have, you know, so it's a constraint, but it's also an opportunity in the sense that we have a deficit for infrastructure estimated at, you know, demand of about $25 billion annually over the next 4 years from 2014, which is based on the National Integrated Infrastructure Master Plan. We have a pension fund that is also growing at, we've got a pension fund growing at an annual rate of 15%. Take it back. Okay. So we have a pension fund growing at an annual rate of 15%. It's currently sized around 6.7 trillion. What is interesting is that even though we have one of the fastest growing pension funds, has one of the lowest penetration rates at 10%. In South Africa, it's about 50%, Kenya, it's about 20%. And so there's still possibly opportunity for growth. So we have a debt capital market. So our debt capital market basically is about 8 trillion in value, in terms of par value. And this is predominantly composed of government security. So we've got federal government bonds composing about 90%, and 10% is composed of state government bonds and corporate bonds. The corporate bonds are less than 3%. But this is very reflective of the portfolio composition of pension funds today, because they largely invest in securities, and because the market is substantially federal government, they have about 80% of their portfolio in government securities. Now there's an increasing need for them to diversify, to hold alternative securities, particularly infrastructure. And so there's an opportunity, which is the fact that pension funds can invest 35% of their portfolio in infrastructure bonds. Infrastructure funds can take 10%. So effectively, we're looking at 45% that potentially can go into eligible infrastructure assets. That's a 3 trillion opportunity. Now, currently, in terms of corporate infrastructure bonds, there's none. And so we're looking at the last point here is that this market is forecasted to grow. We have about 79 million workers, but only about 7 million are registered in the pension scheme. So the penetration rate reflects an opportunity to grow. If the informal sector begins to participate, then that potentially increases the pension fund for. So clearly, what we have here is a growing supply of capital, but limited bankable investments, infrastructure assets to put that capital into. So that brings me to the topic of today, which is, why do we have a structured market in a manner where we cannot allocate long-term capital to eligible assets? I'll talk about infrastructure as an asset class because captive power in itself is within the infrastructure space. And infrastructure effectively are long-term assets with high barrier to entry that typically support the society and key essential services in the society. So the traditional characteristics that infrastructure assets compose of And any investor looking at infrastructure will compare captive power to a grid asset or to a waste management project or to a water distribution project or to a toll road project. They're all infrastructure, they fall within the pocket. So you're competing for capital as an asset, as a sub-asset class within the infrastructure space. So traditionally, infrastructure assets usually are natural monopolies, so there is inelastic demand. It's an essential service, which effectively means that it's resilient, it has a resilience in its asset quality. So default probabilities are typically low. Even if that occurs, the recovery rate is very strong, again, because of the resilience of the asset class. It's inflation linked, so typically you're able to pass through your costs. There's a high barrier to entry, so typically capital intensive. The cash flows are usually very stable and long term. And in terms of economies of scale, typically large size projects, and they're long term assets. And the operating cost is typically low. Now, these are traditional features any investor would look out for when they're testing the quality of an asset. And we'll talk through some of the qualitative aspects of that. And so as a developer or as an operator of a captive project, for example, you would, when a financial advisor is looking over, a potential investor is looking at your asset, they're testing for these quantitative features to see how resilient the cash flows are, because it's a long-term asset and it has to be predictable and it has to be cost-effective. Your tariffs have to be cost-effective. There's a study, there's a Moody's study that indicates that infra assets typically have a lower loss given default levels compared to corporate assets. Again, once you can tick these boxes on an asset, on an investment, generally speaking, you have a lower default probability, unlike a corporate asset that can easily disappear, can go insolvent. These ones, typically because they're essential services, the recovery rates are much better. I'll talk about domestic debt capital market. So this is effectively the platform where you raise money. It's the capital market. And here you see multiple infrastructure assets. We talked about the deficit. And all these assets are searching for long-term capital. And so captive is competing with grid, competing with toll roads, gas, like I said, other asset classes. We talked around the tools through which you can raise capital, either by way of an infrastructure bond or you could go through a fund, you have a fund manager. And the intermediaries are typically the investment bank, fund manager, rating agency. Now these parties help facilitate capital formation. They help prepare you to raise money. And we have our investors. What is important about this market is that it thrives on transparency, accountability, disclosure. And so you find that accessing it, like Bjorn mentioned in his presentation, is not as easy as it sounds. You have to meet some minimum requirements to access this market. I'll talk about that here. Now, typically, like I said, I mean, these assets have to have strong credit quality. They have to be transparent in their operations. The governance level has to be in line with best practices. And then accountability is key. And so there's a saying that capital market is effectively is a beacon of transparency, which means that you, as a company, would need to have full disclosure of your financial information. You have a continuing obligation to do this from time to time. And this affects some businesses. So some businesses may not want to make that level of disclosure, so it constrains them, and they may not be able to directly access the market. Corporate governance is key. Increasingly, the code of corporate governance exists, but increasingly investors tend to pay a lot of attention to this feature. There are minimum standards that are applied. We apply minimum standards when we look at transactions. And I mean, this is simply how is your business being run? What sort of controls are in place? What processes are in place? You see a company, the sole signatory is the chairman. And you can give instructions to transfer money from the bank account to his son, for his son's school fees, just like that. And when you see these things, you take a step back, because it shows you that the controls are weak. And these, to me, I think this is one of the biggest constraints that businesses have in Nigeria in being able to access the capital markets. Because if we're able to conform with some of these requirements, it actually brings in sustainability into our business model. Because then you don't have businesses falling off when the promoter is no longer there or the sponsor is no longer there. You don't have businesses where there's a family problem, the business suffers. So it's increasingly important that we pay a lot of attention to governance. And even in our processes, we try to encourage transactions where, and the equity, when we look at the equity structure, we try to encourage institutional investors to co-invest in the equity, because their DD processes, the governance practices, help improve the profile of the business. So I think it is increasingly important for companies to pay a lot of attention to governance from the very early start, because what you find is by the time they've operated for 5 years and they're looking to raising money, it becomes quite difficult to, you know, untangle these behaviors that have become natural to the businesses and the promoters as well. Credit rating is important, so typically you have to be investment grade. I have a rating agency, I mentioned earlier, that conducts a rating, and it's an annual review. So there's some cost actually to accessing the capital markets. Size and scale, you don't talk about this. It's a very important criteria. So typically you want to have transactions that are sizable. Again, this matters because it affects the cost. The pension funds like to invest in large sizes. And so, you know, a 1 billion transaction wouldn't make sense. Wouldn't make economies of scale. The cost of the transaction would be too low. So traditionally we tend to see deals sizes minimum ticket of 10 billion. That makes sense. And so that is a key factor to take into consideration. So I'll just talk about some key commercial considerations that we look at when we assess captive transactions. And we've had a couple of deals that we're actually looking at currently. Scalability of the project. So we recognize, you know, sometimes you may have transactions that or projects or operating assets that may not have achieved that level of scale. But you can see the outlook, either in terms of the business model, the business plan, the size matters. And the ability to scale your project over time is important. So it's modular projects that can scale, have an advantage. But small projects, just a one megawatt or two megawatt will be difficult. And traditionally, I think these sort of smaller transactions will go through a fund. So you have a fund manager who would invest directly. Cost-effective tariffs. Again, predictability is critical in terms of cash flows. And traditionally what this means is that the company has to have been operational. So a startup business project, a project that is at the early stage will best be financed by a bank. We traditionally see this, and we work, especially when we see such transactions, we work closely with the banks because they're best placed to monitor the construction phase. But the capital market prefers stable, long-term cash flows. And so it's, you know, supposed to be very boring. You just get your payments, it's stable, there are no uncertainties. And so this affects, certainly will affect new projects. But again, we see increasingly banks taking a lot of interest in the ability to exit. So if it proves that the market can take out an operating asset, then banks are willing to invest or lend to construction on the basis that once it's operational, you can raise a long-term bond, you know, to refinance the bank. So the tariffs are important. The contracts are very critical. There are some contracts that may not have, you know, pass-through of costs. You have the liability charge, your fixed and variable costs are critical. So it's important at the very early stages when you're negotiating these contracts, you ensure that you embed these clauses in there to ensure the flexibility. Secure long-term uptake. We only talked about this, it's very critical. We like to see long-term uptake, strong counterparties. Again, if you're selling to a counterparty that is not considered creditworthy, it affects the ability of investors to take on that project risk, that payment risk. So in some instances, you may have payment security. That could come in the form of a bank guarantee, could come in the form of, if it's a state government, it could come in the form of an ISPO. So these payment securities are, I'll say, enhancements that help strengthen the ability to pay. Because sometimes there's willingness, but the ability is another thing. And so that is typically affects the question of cost-effective tax as well, because you may have willing willing buyers, but without the ability to take it. And that's a significant risk. Fuel and gas supply is key. Again, we understand the constraints in obtaining piped gas, but we see transactions where these are taken care of in terms of how the project is structured. You should have the ability to store, you should have alternative options, but the certainty of gas supply is key, because typically your contract, your take or pay contract is tied to availability. If you do not deliver, you don't get paid. And so if you don't have gas, you don't get paid. That impacts on your, you know, on your profit margins, and impacts on your cash flows, and you can't pay. So these are very important key commercial considerations that we take into play when we're looking at prospective, you know, transactions in the captive power space. Okay. Now, this, I don't know how clear this is, but this is an illustrative transaction. We're currently looking at a couple of opportunities, but we find that, you know, there is an opportunity for access to markets, but again, ability to tick these criteria are quite key. Now, this structure shows a bond insurance transaction. So you have, traditionally, what you have is an SPV setup to raise the debt. You may have multiple assets that may be supporting different off-takers. And in aggregate, now, all of these may build up to a large size. And so it could either be one developer or related projects that are operating that have been sized up to, say, 20 megawatts. And so the deal becomes quite sizable. Now, the cash flow from all these assets are used, are secured as a form of repayment. So the SPV is just an issuing vehicle. The transaction typically is rated, and in some instances you may require credit enhancement, which is where InfraCredit will typically come in on a transaction that meets its eligibility criteria. So what happens is the credit enhancement improves the rating of the bond, and this is a guarantee, so an external guarantee on the payment, on the obligation to pay. Implicitly, what this does is it increases the credit rating, thereby makes the bond attractive to institutional investors like the pension funds and insurance companies. There's a no trustee, traditionally, no trustee ensures that there's timely payment of principal and interest and collects that and makes payments to the bondholders. So, this is a traditional structure for a bond transaction where you're going to raise long term debt from the capital markets. In some instances, it could be just one. And that is if the capacity of this entity is large enough and you don't actually require to expand. In some instances, these could increase over time, because what will happen is that as the business expands and acquires other captive projects, it just includes it and increases the cash flow of the entire pool and increases the capacity of the SPV to raise more debt. So again, it's modular, it's incremental, it allows you to tap the market from time to time. So it could be simply a program, and then you issue from time to time, but the issuance has to meet the minimum sort of size that market would like to see. So this slide talks about summarizing some of the key points raised earlier. These are, you know, the mapping of key risks and some of the market considerations for tools to mitigate those risks. So these tie to regulation, operational, commercial. Now, I'll just walk through these points. First is the regulatory framework. We saw the earlier presentation from there. It's important that the framework is clear and predictable. Where there are uncertainties, it impacts on investors' confidence. And so, administrative efficiency is key. And also, clear regulation is also important. And so in situations where regulations are not clear, it does impact on ability to raise capital. So it's always important for MERC to even issue from time to time, if possible, interpretive guidance statements. Where the issues are not very clear, be able to issue, you know, a statement that clarifies this point so that investors can be guided where there's uncertainty. We've had situations where there's uncertainty about how you deal with excess power. Do you sell it to grid at what price? Do you sell it to another party? Now this creates uncertainty, it affects the financial model, and also ultimately builds into your cost of capital. So this is quite critical. Investment grade rating, I talked about the fact that you have to have a minimum investment grade. This typically can be dealt with by credit enhancement, which is where everybody or entities like InfraCredit are told to come in to provide a wrap, so they guarantee your obligations, and that enhances your rating. Long-term predictable cash flows. It's important because you're raising long-term money that the investors are confident that your cash flows also match your liabilities. And it's very important that to achieve this, typically, we'd like to see long-term offtake contracts. So 5-year, 3-year contracts, spot contracts are not attractive. It's risky, and thereby you'll be unable to raise money beyond the tenure of these contracts. Another important point is your off-takers. So you need to have cost-reflective tariffs and also off-takers that are also credible. Where are we here? So the last point we're about on this point, credit enhancement can also support this. But again, we typically wouldn't back a transaction where there's a mismatch of the assets and liabilities. Creditworthy counterparty is also key. Your off-taker, what is their ability to pay? What is their track record? There will be a lot of emphasis in looking at their ability to pay, not just willingness, but ability to pay. And this is a very important factor that any financier would want to understand their track record. So typically, this usually is reflected in the quality of the off-taker. Is it a blue chip entity? Is it just one company that doesn't have much cash flows? Again, this is very critical. So sometimes there's a shadow rating, basically with that counterparty risk. And that implies the credit risk that they will assign to the cash flows of the project, of the company. Institutional capacity. Now, again, I think this ties somehow with governance, but also importantly, the type of team composition, the experience of the team, and also the type of parties you deal with. It's important that the sponsors are seen to be very experienced in the sector and have track record. And so situations where you have entrepreneurs that have limited track record, but are trying to do something good, it's just not enough. You want to see either additional support in terms of the blend of equity structure. So we encourage generally that you bring in an institutional investor that can bring that governance and experience into the business. And also, your EPC contractor or your O&M contractor, what is their reputation, what is their experience, these matter. So they all improve the outlook of the institution, and it also builds confidence with your investor. Inflation-linked income, talked about this, and this basically will be dealt with your tariffs. It has to be cost-reflective. You have to be able to pass through your variable costs. If you're unable to do that, it's difficult to raise long-term money. Macroeconomic factors. I would say that this already will be mitigated by the fact that if your tariffs are cost-reflective, then where inflation moves against you, you're able to pass through that cost. The other macro factor that could be a constraint would be foreign currency. And so, generally speaking, local currency is a better way to fund, especially if your revenues are in local currency. So, again, that is what the local currency capital market exists for. And I'll talk about InfraCredit and how we are looking to support long-term local currency financing. Corporate governance, I think, we talked about this. So, it's important that companies begin to embed best practices. A major constraint for most transactions are governance issues. And I think the earlier we begin to embed this into our business plans, the better it is. Size and capacity, I talked about this. So we need large-scale projects or sizable projects that are scalable. We need experienced sponsors, and we need reputable O&M and EPC contractors. Permits and licenses. Again, this is important. We tend to move with custom and practice in the sense that some businesses, there's a practice that maybe we should license after 2 years. And so, it's accepted. They will do it, but you know, you've written to them. We've had a situation where we were looking at the project and we asked for the permit, and they showed us an acknowledgement letter that was written to them a year ago. And we asked, where's your, he said, they'll give us a license, they'll give us the permit. Usually they have to publish, it takes a year or two. That's what they did for the other ones. And I had the bank lend to you. And that's the difference. So the bank wouldn't really bother about some of these things sometimes, because maybe based on relationships, or some banks, not all banks, but some banks based on relationships or cash flow, you know, you may have some cash or situation from another business and they lend to you. But when you want to raise money from the capital market, this becomes extremely important. So the practice of custom and usage that, oh well, we expect them to provide it, and the market accepts the norm that permits or licenses may be issued after 2 years or after 3 years, but that doesn't stop you from raising money. It will impact your ability to raise capital. And I'm talking about experiences we're having. Again, these are not experiences. Existing projects, they're ongoing, but they're waiting for the permit. And you know, they expect the permit to come, but they can't raise long-term money on the back of such projects. So I think from the regulatory standpoint, it'd be interesting to see whether this is correct or not, and what sort of efficiencies are being built into the system to ensure that licenses are issued timely, permits are issued timely. This clearly has an impact on the ability to attract institutional investors into the capital power sector. So ENS, again, we pay a lot of attention to best practices. We typically adopt IFC performance standards. And so we'd like to see that your HSE policies and your environmental standards are up to best practices. Your EIA reports are in place and you're meeting all your minimum requirements. There are no spillage, there are no degradation. So these are key. Increasingly it's becoming a very important factor in finance decision making. So I think it's something to take particular note of. Okay, so I'll jump into the last slide. So this slide talks about us. So InfraCredit, people of countries. Paraguay has a AA- international rating. That's 10 notches above our sovereign rating. Now, the collaboration between NSI and Paraguay was what resulted in the setup of InfraCredit. The motivation for setting this entity up was because the first slide showed the fact that we have an increasing pool of long-term capital, potentially, and limited investments in infrastructure. And so the feedback was that the pension funds were averse to credit risk, and understandably so. If you recall the earlier slide, it showed the pension fund with an icon, like an egg. You know, so they have to protect capital. Capital protection is critical. And so they required some form of enhancement that can help protect their capital and then motivate them to invest in long-term assets or infrastructure. So we're rated AAA. That's the highest rating by both domestic rating agencies, GCR and Augusto. Our capital supported by both NSI and Barranco, and we also are raising additional capital from a couple of other DFIs. We typically look at local currency only because we're a local currency entity. On our website, you find there's a list of eligible requirements. We typically support at the early stage deals that have operating assets that have track record brownfield. We can support debt tenors of up to 20 years, subject to market conditions and investor appetite. We typically would require the company to be compliant with their pensions because we're targeting pension funds. And there's a minimum rating requirement, that's the minimum investment grade, adequate security package, and again, ENS standards. The way we see the opportunity is that our guarantees are meant to act as a catalyst, and a catalyst to attract long-term funding for pension funds. We try to support transactions that are creditworthy, so we wouldn't take a delinquent transaction, we wouldn't take a delinquent asset. We identify projects or operating assets that, due to constraints with the capital structure, so either they're lending 2-year money with an asset life of 10, 15 years, or they have foreign currency lending, which causes a constraint because of the FX volatility, and they're looking to refinancing this short term to longer term and or raising additional capex funding. And so the access to local currency long-term funding helps de-risk their balance sheet and improve their credit quality. And so our expectation is that the successful operations of InfraCredit would unlock the potential of the capital market. We're looking at a $3 trillion opportunity that needs to go into bankable projects, bankable assets that have predictable long-term cash flows. And so hopefully, all of the points I raised are factors that we consider when we assess or appraise the transaction. And the successful operations of InfraCredit would help unlock best practices, build more resilient businesses, and unlock long-term capital directly, because our guarantees are actually meant to facilitate, not necessarily to guarantee every transaction. And this is what we say. We will help you with your first deal, but what we said for you is to try not to require a guarantee for your next transaction. And so it's now up to the issuer, because you now have access. Today we had a roadshow, a non-deal roadshow with a few pension funds, one of the transactions we're looking at. And bringing that issue up before the pension fund and having a conversation directly with the pension fund is exposing him to a market. One of the pension funds said, look, we have about 600 billion assets under management. A 10 billion transaction is too small for us. And I can understand. But again, you have to scale spend. But is that you actually create a much, much more robust and transparent industry. So I'll stop here, and then we're happy to take any questions. Thank you.